Service was formed. A lot of questions about whether the 16th Amendment is properly ratified in the states of Kentucky and Wisconsin. And they passed this bill in December when most congressmen were on Christmas recess. And I think it passed like 2 or 3 in the morning. But this is how government works. And, you know, my background is in treating feet, medical issues, doing surgery. And it reminds me of a story of 5 surgeons who got together and they went to a seminar. And they're getting their continuing medical education credits. But as surgeons, they're saying, well, who makes the best patient to operate on? If you're going to do surgery, who would be the ideal patient to operate on? And the surgeon from New York says, well, I like accountants. Because when you open them up, everything's numbered. And it's all tax compliant. And the surgeon from Chicago says, well, I like electricians. Because when you open them up, everything's color-coded. And the surgeon from Dallas says, well, I like librarians. Because you open them up, everything is alphabetized, it's cataloged, and everything is in the right order. And the surgeon from Los Angeles says, well, I like construction workers. Because they understand when you do a big job, there's a few parts left over. And finally, the surgeon from Washington, D.C. chimes in and he says, no, you guys have it all wrong. The best patient to operate on are politicians. Because when you open them up, they have no spine, they have no heart, they have no guts, and they have no brains. And their head and their ass are interchangeable. So if you can't appeal to the head, maybe you can appeal to some other part of politicians. And we have a battle royale going on. I think, it's my opinion, but I've studied this, taxation policy is probably the most critical issue in any country. Without taxation, you don't have a nation. There wasn't a United States of America before the states got together and stop the Confederation and said we're going to drop a constitution with the authority of Congress to levy taxes. And they also made it in that constitution you could not impose a tax on the labors of individuals. So they passed, well, in 1913, they passed the 16th Amendment, as I said, under dubious circumstances, to allow the formation of the Internal Revenue Service and thus to collect taxes on the labor of people and corporations. This is going to be, I think, a critical time. You know we're in a mess. Fiscally, financially, culturally, in so many ways. And I think people have often said, well, yeah, the fair tax is a great idea. And I'd like to support it, but it'll never pass. Mm-hmm. That's not true. It can pass. And if you look at every great piece of legislation, whether it was the abolition of slavery, workers' rights, the right of women to vote, civil rights in the 1960s. These were long, hard battles that were fought, starting with the minority, overcoming great odds and great resistance and powerful interests, and they became law. Can I just see a raise of hands of how many people here do understand or know what the fair tax is? Do you really understand the basics of? Okay, so I'm somewhat preaching to the choir here, and I'll try to add some new angles to it. But, you know, the short answer is the fair tax is current legislation. This is not a pipe dream. It is not somebody's economic model or theory. It is current legislation. It is in the Ways and Means Committee in Congress now. It has 76 co-sponsors in the House. It has 8 co-sponsors in the Senate. And I think, you know, you keep hammering at these Florida representatives, and I think we will get that number up. Florida tends to be a conservative state, and I just wanted to point out there are a few people anyway to give kudos to who do support the fair tax here in Florida. So if you're not aware of that, I just want to thank the following congressmen, Representative Bill Arrakis, Gus, Andrew Crenshaw, Ron DeSantis, John Mica, who's on the Transportation Committee, Jeff Miller, Bill Posey, Trey Radel, Dennis Ross, and Ted Yellow. They deserve our commendation, and you maybe ought to send them a thank you letter and, you know, cheer them on, keep going, guys. We want you to keep supporting that. We want more.
What about our local congressman, Dan Webster?
He's out to lunch on that. Yeah. I've gone to his office. I've talked to him personally, face to face. I've written him. I write to him just about every month. I keep urging him. I mean, he's going to keep seeing. He must know my address by heart. But, you know, Dan Webster is that political animal who puts his finger to the wind, and I don't think he feels enough wind behind his sails to push the fair tax. But I think he's convertible. I think, you know, if we get enough people and we have enough momentum, this idea will catch fire. You hear politicians now talking about tax reform, and the ultimate tax reform is the fair tax. I believe if you want to invigorate this economy, if you want to create jobs, invite investment capital to this country, make your life a lot easier, and really help get fairness and equity in our tax system, you need to support the fair tax, and it can happen. And by the way, that number of co-sponsors, I think, has grown by three just in the past 6 months, because I think there were 72, 73 co-sponsors last November. So it's gaining ground. Just think about this for a second. People say, well, you know, we need the income tax system because it provides so many shelters. Yes, tax is the structure that provides for civilization. We need tax. But think about this. In the 140 years from 1790 to 1930, without an income tax really in effect for most of that time, this country grew from a rustic bunch of colonies, disorganized, to become the greatest cultural, industrial, economic, and military power in the world. We did that by the rule of law and by guaranteeing individual rights and property rights. And I think property is essential. Without property rights, you don't have civilization. And most essential in that property is what you earn. So the key provision of the fair tax is you keep everything you earn. It abolishes all forms of income tax to include your personal income tax, corporate tax, payroll tax, which includes Medicare and Social Security deductions, capital gains, dividends, and interest taxes, gift taxes, and estate taxes. So just think about the incentives this would provide for that $13 trillion that's sitting offshore in the coffers of corporations looking to invest. We would no doubt become the economic magnet of the world. And one of my fears is that some country like Brazil, or who knows what else, might decide, hey, let's try the fair tax. And they would become the attraction for all this investment capital. And you'd see factories and value-added industries popping up in that country like there's no tomorrow. We could do that. We could be that country. And we should. And if you're going to be true, I think, to the Republican ideals or to our founding fathers' principles, you want smaller, limited government, and you want to encourage and incentivize the production of wealth. The best way to do that, as Larry Kudlow says, is free market capitalism. And free market capitalism works best when you don't have 74,000 pages of IRS code to deal with. You don't have to file 940s and 941s on your employees. You don't have to file 1040, 1040A, or an 1120S if you're a subchapter S corporation. All these things add a burden, and you can play with the numbers, but think about $400 billion a year in tax compliance costs. That's an awesome number. So even if you want to argue about will we collect enough money with the fair tax, think about the unburdening of everybody's business, mom and pop's little restaurant all the way up to General Motors. The country would boom financially, and the economists have studied this, showing that our GDP would grow. By the end of 10 years, our GDP growth would be 10% greater than what it is now. Employment would grow, and you would find more consumer activity. Ironically, people say, well, if you tax consumption, if you put a sales tax on everything, people won't want to buy new stuff. And has been shown, no, that will not happen. It won't discourage charity either, because people give to charity based on not their deduction on a 1040, but on their willingness to provide for the benefit of others and to share their own wealth. When you have more, you give more. And you're going to have more if you can keep your whole paycheck and you don't have to comply with the IRS code. You decide when to pay your tax by when you buy something that's end-line retail. So only first-time items, a new house, a new car, a new yacht, a new jet plane will pay the burden of the taxes. And then I heard the argument that, well, this is going to put a kibosh on the real estate market because it's going to really mess up the mortgage interest deduction. And nothing could be further than the truth. Has anybody heard that argument? Oh, what are we going to do with the mortgage interest deduction if we get rid of it? Because actually, would you like to have a maybe 2% reduction in your tax bill with that, or a 100% reduction of your income tax? I'd rather pay no income tax and forget about that. And by the way, it would actually add value probably to all the existing homes. If you have an existing home, which most people do, they would not have to pay sales tax on that. Those who want to buy a new home will. But eventually, the financial markets will balance this out, the comparables will kick in, and all homes will be fairly valued. And bankers will loan for what the cost of a new house is. They're going to put a package together. And another false argument was presented that, well, if you put a sales tax of 23% on a new home, that's really going to make bankers think twice, because where's their equity, where's their collateral if 23% of that is a tax payment to the government? It's all packaged in. Also, factor in that people who say, I don't pay income tax, 47% of Americans don't pay federal income tax, well, maybe they don't, but everything they buy, everything they purchase has an embedded payroll tax in it, has embedded corporate taxes in it, has all kinds of compliance costs that go into the making of this land. And so, if you take those out, the production of everything we have, the sales tax will kick in and essentially replace that. And if competition works its wonders, you're going to have probably more boom in the economy and more free flow of cash. It will accelerate the velocity of money, so everybody's going to benefit. It's a win-win-win. Another item that people have some question about is the prebate. The prebate is not an entitlement. Prebate is not a welfare check. The prebate is an offset to the sales tax you paid up to the poverty level. So you can never say, well, it's unfair to the poor. If you, the average family of four now estimated to pay if they're earning $31,000 in income, they would get a prebate back that offsets all the taxes that they pay for the basic necessities of life. The FairTax people in devising this did not want to have us picking and choosing, well, should we tax an ice cream cone if you buy it at a vendor, but not tax ice cream if you buy it in a grocery store because it's food? We don't want to get into those arguments of parsing and deciding what's taxable and non-taxable. Just give you a prebate. You decide what your essentials are for life, for food, medicine, clothing, and housing, and the offset takes care of that. That, in effect, that prebate, which all legal residents and citizens of this country get, if you're registered and you're a citizen, you get that prebate based on your household size. If you're not registered, if you're an illegal immigrant, you don't get it. So, in effect, that prebate creates a progressivity to the tax code. Those at the bottom, if you make less than $31,000 as a family, your essential tax rate is zero. And as you go up in that, the tax rate goes up and up and up. When you get into the hundreds of thousands of dollars, then your tax rate might effectively get to be 21-22%. But you choose what you want to pay tax on, when you want to buy, how you want to buy, what you feel you want as a new retail item. And it does tax services also. But from every angle I can study and look at this, this would really be the most forceful change that we would have in our country. And I think you want to tell your Republican congressman, too, that they've done studies to show that a challenging campaigner who's new to politics, if he actively supports the fair tax, if he says, I'm for it, and I'm willing to defend it, and I really propose this, eliminates the advantage an incumbent politician has over him in campaigning. And I don't mean somebody who just says, yeah, the fair tax is okay, that's fine. I mean somebody actively says, I want the fair tax, and is willing to defend it against the tax and critics. So, this is something that we can really use to our advantage in approaching any politician. I've spoken to Alan Hayes and Larry Metz about it. Larry understands it, and he's for it in principle, but he wants to see the language of how this would be. We were trying to get a memorial done from the state legislature in Florida to support, in theory, and enforce the fair tax idea, so the people up in Washington, our U.S. representatives, would know Florida representatives behind this. So it never hurts to talk to your local state senators and representatives and get them on board too. Tell them you want real tax reform and you would like to see them endorse and make a resolution in the Florida legislature that you support H.R. 25 in the House and Senate Bill 122, because this will create good for everybody. And I'm going to open this up for questions. I'm going to also leave you with a copy. I think you should see this for your group and keep it on file. This is the original 1913 income tax. Four pages. It explains. And in those days, you had to actually go to a tax collector because so few people were paying it. You had to be fairly rich. And they would certify it, and you'd have to file an affidavit, a sworn affidavit, that these are true and correct. But the first $3,000 is tax-free. The amounts over $3,000 are taxed at 1%. So we tried the flat tax. Here was the flat tax, the original one. And look what had happened. It didn't last long. And of course, the real bad turn of events came in World War II, where we instituted the payroll tax. We started deducting income tax from people's paychecks. Kind of silently, you don't miss it if you don't see it. But that was not a good thing, and I think that's what's embedded this. And of course, you know, in 1986, we eliminated a lot of the deductions and exemptions and made a supposedly simplified tax code with two tax rates, 14 and 28%. Another flat tax attempt failed miserably. So if you want to get rid of the weed, you have to rip it out by the roots. You can't just clip the leaves. This is a corrupt system. As George Will said, every line in those 74,000 pages of tax code has its own constituency. It was put there by a special interest group, carving out their niche, whether it's an investment tax credit for this industry, an allowance for sheep herders or helium producers, or if you want to get some kind of oil depletion allowance for drilling, let's make us all equal citizens and everybody has an equal opportunity to be the best they can, and I think we can do the job and get this thing passed if more people get on board. It's not going to be easy, it's not going to happen this year, but I think if the Republicans take the Senate, as I think they will, and we get a Republican in the White House in 2016, this will move to the top quite quickly. But it has to start as a grassroots issue. All of us have to get behind our congressmen, locally and federally, and start keeping this agenda going. And they keep seeing people, letters come across their desk, fair tax, fair tax. They're going to rethink things. So, you know, every letter represents 30 other constituents. And if you're sending in a letter, I like to send in postcards, because the postman sees it, takes it, the postman who delivers it sees it, the clerk in the Congress sees it as he delivers it to the desk. So it's really easy for a lot of people to see. And I put a fair tax If you look over there, we have a little ticket that explains the FairTax. When I pay my bills, I take that to the back of the envelope on the outside, so the postman sees that too. And everybody who passes that will look at the back of that letter and say, huh, keep my whole paycheck. I don't have to file any report on capital gains. I don't have to file a tax return on business. Hmm, let me think about that. So I'm going to leave this for the Republican women. Keep this on file. It's a beauty. It shows you where we've been and how far we've come. And two questions I think all of us should really ask every representative in Washington. And I still have to get a good answer for this. And some people have said this before. When you go to a town hall meeting, just ask them, why can't you support the FairTax, HR 25? Tell me why. Tell me why you want to defend the current tax code and put them on the defensive. Next question, what do you think is a fair percentage of confiscation for the median household income to fund all levels of government, federal, state, and local? Does anybody here have an idea what a fair percentage would be? Anybody want to volunteer that?
15% like Hong Kong.
Yeah. Or even 12% like Russia. I mean, you know, that would be beautiful. But the studies they've shown have the median household spending about 52% of what they take in to fund all levels of government. Now, I know this is a little bit outside the realm of the income tax, but when you add it all in, when you flip a switch on your electricity, you turn on the water, you listen to your cell phone, you turn on the cable TV, your property taxes on the house, you drive a car, you fill it with gas, it's taxed at every level. And so if you have a working couple, one of those spouses is working just to fund government, to me that's an outrage, and it's serfdom. And I think it's time to get angry and to do something about that. So maybe we have to, you know, kick a few butts, but get in people's faces about that, that we need this change, and it can happen. I would encourage you all to go to fairtax.org. You know, look up the research. This is really good there. They have white papers. They have analysis by economists. They have current thinking that's going on in blogs. But you'll find out at all levels there's a growing interest in this. And if you have any misunderstandings or myths about it, we can eliminate them.
How does this impact the national deficit?
Well, as I said, it would grow GDP, and revenues would increase. Expenditures on the federal side are a whole other matter. I mean, we need entitlement reform. We need all kinds of restraints on the growth of government. But this is a revenue-neutral tax. It will fund the government in all its operations, including Medicare and Social Security, because there's a division of the fair tax which is collected to support those. So you don't have to worry about Social Security and Medicare being deducted from your paycheck anymore. But those are the two biggies when you think about expenditures. You know, 70% of our federal budget expenses now are transfer payments. That means the government is paying a check to somebody or some institution for doing work. That's outrageous. I mean, that's not sustainable. We can't keep saying, 52% of the Americans pay an income tax, and we're going to fund all the people who get a government check of one sort. So, I mean, we have the essential functions of government, national defense being the number one, but we have way outgrown what the role of government should be with entitlements. All the regulatory agencies.
Any other questions?
I got one.
Yes, Vance.
Yep.
Have you seen any details to explain how they would transition if FairTax was approved? Because you're going to have a pipeline full of products that all have the embedded tax in them, and then what? Do you add the new sales tax on top of those, or you have a forgiveness or credit process? Has anybody really explained that you can tell us about?
It's in the legislation, and they have a lot of formulas for that. It gets really complex, but essentially, if you bought something prior to the FairTax, and there is a transition period, it's considered you've already paid the tax on that item. And thus also used items, if you purchased it, you don't, if you transfer it to somebody else, you don't pay a sales tax again. But the IRS would continue in existence to collect the back taxes owed. If you had a current debt to the IRS, that does not go away, you still have to pay that. But there is, I think, a two-year phase-in where a lot of these things have to be phased out. But essentially, your current tax bill would stop with no more income tax, and within 7 years, the IRS is essentially sunsetted. I'm sorry, the 16th Amendment is sunsetted out unless Congress decides to repeal the Fair Tax. But if the Fair Tax is still in existence, the 16th Amendment goes away, thus making it unable for the government to do any more taxation on income. Yeah.
I have tons of questions, but I think my first one is I saw that the Social Security Administration will be handling now.
Can you speak
louder?
That the SSA will be handling the pre-tax. I work in a place every week. I hear someone who's not a legal alien but gets Social Security benefits. You know, why do they think that the Social Security Administration that it will be any different, that they'll be checking on people? And I know I was reading that it said they have to have Social Security number. Well, they can get those easy enough. People that are in jail who aren't out spending tax money, how are you going to know they're in jail? My thing is, why should I think that the SSA is going to be any better, any different with Fair Tax than they are with all the stuff that they have now?
Well, the SSA needs reform, and that's really a separate track. But
don't we the cart in front of the horse kind of thing? Shouldn't we try to do that before? Because this could be very costly, just sending out checks every month. I mean, we do it as it is now, obviously, when people are getting benefits.
The checks going out would only come based on after taxes are collected, and you're untaxing what was collected. The illegal aliens would not get that prebate. So
these people have to prove that they've spent money?
No. They would have to prove that they're a U.S. citizen.
Okay, but
and they reside in this country, and so they're legal residents.
Right, but I'm already saying that's already a problem. We already have people who have all the papers that they need, but they're not real papers.
There's actually, I think I can help you.
David, I want to address that, okay?
I don't mean to be difficult.
Yeah,
no, that's right. David works in the tax collector's office, so
where it kind of comes into play here is we're getting the driver's license board, which is Homeland Security, which is the real ID Act, which gets involved in Social Security. And there's a difference, and when you get into, they call it FDR, the Fraudulent Document Recognition Process, and it's got to do with legal presence, what the right presence, some people call it, whatever. But anyhow, in that process, there are indicators in these databases of someone's status. And generally there's three statuses. You're either illegally, you're either a non-citizen with legal presence, or you're a citizen, which obviously is rhetorical to say, with legal presence. And if you can get Social Security numbers, because you have folks that are within the non-citizen that are legal, you have the immigrant and non-immigrant. And in that category, they do issue Social Security cards because they're collecting Social Security because they're working and earning it.
Right.
So I would dare venture to say that it would be a better proposition to see IRS go away and have that savings, and to know you're using three identifiers in that database to determine a prebate. Because I've read some of these white papers, and they're pretty well thought out. And the other one is the collection on the tax side is, for example, in Florida, would be through existing entity in the Department of Revenue,
exactly,
with, which would also get paid a certain percentage.
Right. I mean,
it's a very good point, but it is ferreted out, and that would be a policy issue or something that the Congress, if they decide to give away the farm, I mean, that can happen. But as far as the mechanism in place, and I'm a critic, believe me, where I am politically polarized more to the right, so I say that.
Well, you have to also consider, yeah, it's a separate track. It does need reform, but look at what the incentives would be. With the IRS gone, and all funding and Social Security dependent on the collection of that sales tax, I think he'd have a whole new entity involved in the collection of that sales tax. And they're going to be a lot more discerning about who's a legal resident and deserving of a prebate than what the current Social Security administration is now, which is basically a political vote-buying machine. You can't touch Social Security, as any politician knows, without risking losing your vote. So I think to have that somewhat separated and decoupled from the IRS would be a good thing and provide the right incentives for real reform in that area. Immigration reform is a whole other animal. That is something we have to do too. But entitlement reform, I think, once you have the tax reform, entitlement reform would follow with it. It's just,
Since, am I correct that the FairTax is going to be legislation rather than a constitutional amendment? Is that correct?
It's legislation.
Okay, so if that's true, then what you're saying about it will get rid of the ability to have an IRS, unless you repeal the 16th, then another Congress could always come back, amend, repeal the fair tax, because it's just legislation. You have to essentially go back and repeal the 16th.
Well, written in that legislation is the repeal of the 16th Amendment.
But you can't amend.
It's abolished.
Repeal,
it's abolished.
Unless you have constitutional amendment repealing it as part of the prohibition.
No, not with the legislation. This amendment would go away by the legislation. It sunsetted.
Did we repeal the prohibition one by legislation, or didn't we?
I believe it was legislation. They did not. I don't think they ran the amendment process through the states to get that repealed in 1933.
Didn't we create another amendment when we
repealed it? That's a good question. I don't know how that worked with prohibition, but I'm pretty sure it was legislated out.
You also, legislatively, if it's written, it also have a default in it where it would shut off at that point. So either you could slice it through there.
Right. I think that can be done, but,
Does your legislation have something in it that would keep it from them deciding, 4 years from now, instead of 23% or maybe 50%?
But see, that's the beauty of the FairTax. You have one number you can zero in on that everybody knows. When they buy an ice cream cone or a new car, they know exactly what that percentage is.
No, I know that, but I'm talking about our people up in Washington. And I'm a skeptic always. A skeptic. But what would keep them from saying, we've got so many more, what's Paul's doing up there now? Because there's so many more expenses. We're going to have to take it from 23 to 50.
They can always do that, but that's
actually, but there's immediate feedback.
Right.
It's like the homestead exemption. The homestead exemption is disastrous, believe it or not. And the reason it is because so many of us got insulated, very insulated, when all these other assessments and stuff that wasn't protected, like commercial property, things of that nature, they were saying the millage was staying the same, but the values were going up, and they didn't have Save Our Homes protection. So here comes this cash flow coming out of the pockets of taxpayers going into the coffers. Well, I'm sitting in my home and all the rest of us, man, everything's wonderful. If we would not have had homestead exemption, every one of us is second that we saw that tax bill start the next year go from, say, line from $2,000 to $2,500 or $2,100, you would have gotten quite an electorate stirred up. So I think, if I'm following what I've read about this, is you put it right back to the minute as a elected official, if you tamper with that rate, it shows up at that register the minute you buy anything, and you get that immediate impact of it, and you get a bigger outcry from the electorate, versus this whole scheme of take it out of your paycheck now, and it's just gone. Yeah. And nobody knows it, especially when you start leaving certain people out of the damage, which is how I think that Florida will wind up with an income tax, they'll exempt retirement.
Right.
So then you get a block to the vote, and they'll say, well, drop sales tax and bring in the income tax, but retirement money won't count. And then you'd have enough people to vote it in.
Now, the key is that you have one rate that's fully visible. Yeah, you would have one rate that's fully visible by everybody. Everybody has equal skin in the game, unlike the current code of income tax, where you can say, well, that doesn't apply to me, that doesn't apply to me, and somebody else is taking the tax rap, not me. That's how you legislate and get these things done. Where if you've got 140 million taxpayers, well, that would become 318 million taxpayers who all know what that percentage is, and they all can zero in on a congressman and say, don't you dare raise that 1 point above 23%.
Talk about Twitter.
You talk about a storm, yeah. That would be the end of that congressman, you know, because it's fully visible. And everybody, that's the beauty about this. It broadens the tax base, so everybody has some skin in the game and they know what's involved. And they're going to be really focused on anybody who tries to change it. So remember that 1913 tax return, 1% on the top, I think, 0.1% of people in this country. So it doesn't affect me. Tax not me, tax not thee, tax the man behind the tree. That's how they passed it.
Thank you very much.
I'll be glad to answer any questions afterwards. And we have